You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where we talk about combining OpenAI models with the power of Azure. New from Build. Make sure you tune in. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI Show, where we're going to talk about combining OpenAI models with the power of Azure with Chris, my friend. How are you?
I'm doing great. Yeah, thanks for having me.
Fantastic. So tell us who you are and what you do.
Yeah, so I'm Chris Hoder. I am the lead product manager on the Azure OpenAI Service, and I'm excited here to talk about what we're building.
So let's talk about the Azure OpenAI Service. People probably have heard of OpenAI, but now we're putting it together with Azure. Can you tell us about what we announced at Build?
Yeah, so this week at Build, we're really excited to announce the limited access public preview of the Azure OpenAI Service. And so what that means is customers out there can start to apply for access to be able to use OpenAI's models in Azure today across to use that for a huge number of language use cases.
And that's really cool, but they could have used that in OpenAI. What makes it doing it in Azure even better?
Yeah, so what makes it even better in Azure is that we provide a lot of what, you know, is often thought of as just the core goodness of Azure. We have security with Azure Active Directory-based authentication for managed identities. You can do private networking with virtual networks and private links, and a whole swath of other features that really empower enterprises to take advantage of this tech in a really secure way.
Interesting. So if you want to try all the latest and greatest OpenAI, still go there. But if you're trying to put it into an enterprise setting, you want to do it with Azure. Am I getting this right?
Yeah, exactly. That's a great way to think about it.
Fantastic. So I was hoping you could show us a little bit about how it works.
Yeah, definitely. Let's hop into a quick demo.
All right, let's do it.
So what you're seeing here is what we call the Azure OpenAI Studio. And this is our new UI that lets users quickly iterate and experiment with their use case. And that becomes really important with something like OpenAI's models because they are super flexible. And I want to show you a little bit about how flexible they are. And so what we have here is a simple text interface where I can copy in text and call it against the model. And what's unique about these types of large language models is you actually define the task with what you put into the prompt and send to the model to generate text. And so in this example that I'm showing first, I have you could imagine you're an insurance company and you want to understand what's being said in emails and other communications with your customers. And so we have a fictitious email here where somebody's emailing about an accident their son had with another driver. And you can imagine you want to start to ask questions on this data set, such as who was involved in the accident? Can I extract the names? And so all I have to do here is ask who are the names of the people involved in the accident. And you can see that the service analyzes that text and generated the correct answer with Jacob and Marina, which if you read through this, you know, son with the driver is Jacob, the other driver was named Marina. It's really just that easy.
That's amazing. And it's amazing for me because when I was studying machine learning, my first NLP task was extracting entities, and just that the model does all of it is really, really cool.
Yeah, it's fantastic. It can save a ton of time to really get started and iterate quickly. And to show you even how powerful it is, next I want to use the same model, same interface, and do a different task. And so you think about extracting entities. Sometimes you want to extract like this example, but other times you want that in a structured format. And so here I have a set of text that describes, you know, a new planet called Gucrux. And fruits that are available.
I've been there. And, yeah, it's wonderful.
Yeah, wonderful place. And if you click generate, you can see that it starts to create a table summarizing the fruits from Gucrux in a structured format. I'll just run that one more time so people can see. You know, I gave it a couple of examples. I click generate and it understands that structure and start to pulls it out. And so you can see Loop Novas, neon pink, cotton candy like. You know, there's plenty of Loop Novas, which are neon pink flavor, tastes like cotton candy.
That's really cool. Even like things that may seem nonsensical, it still makes a little bit of sense on it.
Yes, exactly. Cool. Yeah. And we can go even further, right? So we've shown structured text. We've shown asking questions. It can also do, you know, more classical tasks like classification. And so a simple example here, we can classify the following article into one of these categories. And I'm defining these categories at runtime, right? So it's dynamic classification that's not going through that historic training loop, passing the news article, and just click generate, and it'll come back with the correct classification.
That's really cool. And this is just a model without any frill. This is just the standard DaVinci model.
Yeah, it's a great question. Yeah, so same model in all three cases. It's called our Text DaVinci 001 model, which is one of the standard base GPT-3 models.
I see. And so I'm guessing there's other models in there too that you can work against that have varying degrees of accuracy, size, whatever.
Yeah, it's a great question. So there's actually two different pivots on this you could think about. There are models that have various degrees of size, and we call those the Ada, Babbage, Curie, and DaVinci model series. Okay. And so DaVinci being the most powerful, biggest model, Ada being much smaller. And you know what we really see is that's a trade-off between inferencing time. So smaller models will compute faster, you get higher throughput, versus capabilities and performance. And so DaVinci, you get the best performance, but it's going to take a little bit longer. And so what we see is after solution, there's a bit of an optimization step where you might look at, you know, can I solve my task with Curie and maybe do it a little bit faster, a little bit cheaper? Or can I go all the way down to Ada? And you start to optimize down as you progress through that production journey.
That's cool. So as we're looking at this, if you want to show more examples, that's awesome. Show them. But I also want to ask the question, there's probably a time when these models get you most of the way there, but it feels like you need to do something a little bit more specific. After you show us more examples, if you have any, I'd love to know, how do we make these models more attuned to data that I might have, for example?
Yeah, that is a great question. I have one more example and then we'll hop into that. The other example looks at, you know, you mentioned there's multiple different flavors of the model. So we looked at the text GPT-3 series, which is the base series that you've probably heard about with OpenAI. What I also wanted to show quickly was our Codex model series. And the Codex model series came from a partnership with GitHub, really looking at training these models on large corpuses of open source code. And so how do you do code-based tasks, natural language to code, code to natural language for code commenting? And is one of the underlying model type that's used to power our GitHub Copilot feature, for example. And so I'll change the model, but I won't change anything else here. And so we're using the same API structure, same type of call. And I will copy in a little example here where imagine I want to do some code commenting, which I personally always leave till the very end of my projects. And so there's super helpful tool. And so we have a method here that'll randomly split a data set. And I'm basically asking for an elaborate, high quality doc string for the above function.
And this is documentation that we would always write. That's pretty cool.
Right. Yeah. Always write this. Yeah.
Delightful. I mean,
so that. Good.
Just the fact that, because this is code that we've all kind of written, but the fact that it writes this good of a doc string is delightful.
Yeah, it's awesome. And it can be a big time saver for tons of different use cases. But I think it is also important to call out what you were mentioning earlier. In some cases, you know, if you have a complex task or it's really industry specific, you find that out of the box, it's not going to quite get you there. And so that's where we have the fine tuning process, which is taking these same models, customizing the actual weights. And so everything here that we're showing, you know, you're not changing the actual model or any of its weights. You're just providing it context at that call time. And so what you can do right in this UI or via APIs, you can go over to this model section and actually go and create a customized model. And the way you create that customized model is starting with one of these base model series. So I'll choose Ada here, which is one of the smaller models that'll train real fast. And then you update your training data. And so a training or validation data set. And so here I have a training set and a validation set. And you can also then start to tune some of the hyperparameters. If you don't quite know what these are, you can go with some of the defaults and it'll train a decent model right out of the box. So we'll kick that off and that'll start to train. Once that's complete, you can then go and deploy these models for inference. And what I'm training here is it's a set of data that trains the models to speak like Homer. And so we've added a lot of training, different examples of Homer's writings and scripts to try to convert how the model talks and provide a more ancient Greek flavor to our conversations.
And this is something we did in one of our breakouts and in the keynote at Microsoft Build, just because I was interested, like literally, I was interested to see what marketing copy would look like in the style of Homer, not Simpsons, by the way. Homer, from Homer, Greek Homer.
Right. Exactly. And so I've taken that same data here, walked you through the process just to show you how that would look. And we have it running here. And so you can start to ask very interesting questions to get some of that Homerian flavor out of it. So we can ask it, you know, why is the AI show awesome?
Let's see. Yeah, I mean, these two questions are synonymous. Why is the AI show awesome? Why the dark frowns cast o'er his brows? Because they weren't watching the AI show, I think, Chris, is what we're trying to figure out what's going on here. This is really funny.
Yeah, so you could start to play around with this, and you can also see the iterative nature where you do experiment with those prompts to figure out the right way to use it for every use case. So maybe I should have asked, why should I watch this?
This is literally, someone actually said that to me the other day. I have watched enough of it. Thank you for the confidence boost there, specialized. Now, this is all very humorous, but there may be a situation where organizations have specialized vocabulary, a specialized way of putting things together, that fine-tuning will bear this out. Because I'm looking at this, it looks like I'm reading like the Iliad from Homer or something.
Right, right.
So, like, are we seeing organizations do stuff like this?
So we are, yes. We're seeing lots of organizations start to pick up fine-tuning, really apply it to their specific use cases. And it typically, you get a lot of mileage understanding what's possible, how we might use these models by iterating on these prompt designs with the base models. And then you start to learn, develop the data set to go and train with, you know, at least a couple hundred examples for things like summarization in very specific use cases, whether that's financial information, financial statements, customer support conversations, or even medical documents, right? All of those have their own flavor of jargon, different types of words are being used, as well as you might have different sets of important information. And that really becomes easier to extract with the fine-tuning process.
Awesome. So this is all really, really cool. But one of the things that is always top of mind, at least for me, when I'm using these kinds of generative models, is the notion of using them responsibly. How are we helping folks use this responsibly?
Yeah, that's a great question. It's something that's really top of mind for us as we start to broaden access to the service in the public preview. And so it's one of the main reasons why we did progress very slowly with invite only. And now, even now, we're going to ask customers to apply and submit their use cases to ensure that, you know, the service and this generative capability isn't being misused or abused for, you know, malicious purposes. And then within the product, we're actually starting to develop a set of product tools to help our customers develop the applications responsibly. We're starting with what we call content filtering, content management. And so what's going to happen is when you or a customer makes an API call, does this generation step, both that prompt and the generated text will get evaluated against a series of classifiers for, you know, really, you know, to identify abuse or misuse. And so looking for kind of those very high sensitive topics, like, is it hate speech or is there, you know, violent content being sent? And we'll actually start to filter that out and block it to ensure that that kind of content does not go back to the customer.
I see. So we're doing content filtering based upon those axes that you described on the way in, essentially, as well as on the way out. Am I getting that right?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. So it's actually looking for somebody that is on the way in trying to misuse it, and then as well stopping any bad generation on the way out.
Well, I mean, that's awesome, because like I said, that's the one concern I have with generative models is could it make people feel excluded? Could it say things that are untoward? And we're doing a lot of work already to make sure that that does not happen.
Yeah, I totally agree. I think it's one of many tools. We found that, you know, no one single solution is going to solve the whole problem of abuse and misuse. And so there's, you know, the gating, there's these filtering tools. And then the third big one that we do have and we're working on is, you know, solution design. So how do our customers design in a responsible way? And that's not unique to the Azure OpenAI service. You know, it's an AI problem, and Microsoft is really investing a lot across the company in providing guidelines, research, and ideas of how customers can do that. And so, you know, we'll start to incorporate that into our documentation within the Azure OpenAI service as well.
Well, amazing. Where can people go to find out more, maybe sign up, learn more?
Yeah, I think there's a link right below us on where to go and sign up. You have to go apply for access. You can start doing that today. You just have to provide a little information on what you intend to do with the service, and so that we can ensure that it matches against our responsible AI policies.
Which is, again, another axis of how we're doing, another axis along the line of how we're doing this responsibly, I think, which is really cool.
Yeah, agreed.
All right. Well, this has been amazing, Chris. Thanks so much for spending some time with us, my friend.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Can't wait to be back.
Awesome. All right. You've been learning all about combining OpenAI models with the power of Azure here on the AI Show. Thank you so much for watching, and hopefully we'll see you next time. Take care.